Hey everybody, welcome to Wood Chat for September 4th, 2013. I'm Matt Gradwell from Uppercut Woodworks. You can find me on the web at uppercutwoodworks.com or on Twitter at uppercutwood. Hey, if you're watching the video and you want to play along with the kids in the chat room, head over to uppercutwoodworks.com/woodchat/chatroom, log in with your Twitter ID, and you can play along in the chat and watch the video all on one easy page. With me tonight, as always, is my buddy Chris. Hey, Chris.
Hello, everybody. Chris Wong here. I'm in the show today from Port Moody, my shop where I always am. You can follow me online on Twitter at Flair Woodworks and follow my blog at flairwoodworks.com/blog. And you can also see my work there. Tonight, we have another host with us, Scott Meek. How are you doing, Scott?
Hey, everybody. Scott Meek. You can find me at scottmeekwoodworks.com and smeekwoodworks on the Twitters.
All right. And our special guest today, our latest participant in the telephone game, is Bill Griggs. How are you tonight, Bill?
I'm doing great, Chris. Thank you.
Where can people follow you on Twitter, and how can we see more of your work?
They can follow me at Bill Griggs. On Twitter, and I have a blog on MakerMasters.com.
There you go. And that's Bill Griggs, G-R-I-G-G-S.
That's right.
All right. So, Matt, where are we going to start tonight?
Well, I think the first announcement Bill has to make is, Bill, is all that stuff on your face new since last time?
Yeah. I thought I'd try something different. That's how you can tell you're in midlife there.
That's a sign of reputable and trustworthy.
Oh, is that what that is?
Yes, yes. Don't trust men without beards.
I'm a deviant.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay, that's good. Says the guy drinking a beer in the wood shop.
I'm not working at the moment. I'm just
yeah. All power tools are off. Yeah.
I wouldn't really call it working, Scott. So what I thought.
All right, I do have one.
Bill, you were a guest on Wood Chat a long time ago. I think it'd be interesting if you. Kind of give people an update on your background and some of the things you do, and especially around the work you do with high schools and other schools on building CNCs and things like that. So,
well, a couple of years ago, I was a model airplane designer, and I used to make model airplane kits and things like that, and that kind of got me interested in woodworking and particularly in power tools. So I saw a kit come out from Germany a long time ago that was just flawless. It had beautiful tab and groove construction and everything just indexed together very nicely, and I wondered how they did that. And so I found out that that was through the use of a CNC router table. And so then I spent the next couple of years trying to research and find out what one of those was and how I could get one, and quickly discovered that I couldn't afford one. So, like most of you, when you can't afford something, you go out and you make it, and that's what I did. So I went out and I built my own CNC router table, and then about the time I got that up and running, I was posting on a lot of forums and things like that. So, you know, folks are following this odyssey. And so about that time, my neighbor happened to come across him. My neighbor's a very good woodworker, Jeff. And I made a sign for him for his camper. And when I got the sign done, he really liked it. And he told one of his college roommates about it. And his roommate just happened to be assistant director at a manufacturing mechanical engineering and technology program at one of the local colleges. So they somehow wrangled an invitation to come on over to the shop and to check out the machine, and so they did. And they came over and they were very impressed with it, and it ended up at the end of that session that they asked me if I would consider coming down to the college to you know, just kind of help out and assist them, because they wanted to build a router table as the senior project. And so that ended up with me going out and, you know, volunteering down there, and we built a 4x4 CNC router table, and then we showed the kids how to use it, and then they went on and on from there. And you know, it's really been a lot of fun. I've been blogging about it and sharing it with people and anyone who wanted to learn how to do that. So that's some of my background.
So that's cool. So when you were first doing the model airplanes and you didn't have a CNC, were you building them with traditional woodworking power tools and hand tools, or what were you doing?
Yeah, I was it started out at first when I was building the kits that I was using a bandsaw, a little Dremel jigsaw, and some you know, sanding disc and things, and I was hand cutting each of these wing ribs out using the hand tools and getting everything all ready and nice and sanding them and creating all these kits, and you know, you'd batch them. I taught myself CAD, so I could do the blueprints and everything, and then I built a vacuum forming machine, and you know, it just goes from there. That's how we did it.
Cool.
Yeah.
So then you got into CAD and CNC, and now are you getting back more into more of the kind of the traditional woodworking techniques and beyond beyond airplanes? Didn't you build a desk?
Yes, I did. I'm a little bit hesitant to call that a really good desk, but it was a it's what I'm sitting at right now. It's a tool-less joinery system where you don't need any tools to put the desk together. It's all slot and tab.
Mm-hmm.
I got some veneered plywood and just cut out the shapes, and it's not conventional in shape at all.
Mm-hmm.
But I, you know, did all the work in CAD, figured out how things had to fit, and then I went about putting it together, and it was probably my first major woodworking project, other than building some cabinets from Wood Magazine.
Cool.
Yeah. Sounds like an interesting desk, Bill. Do you have a picture of that?
I can get one for you.
There's one on your blog, isn't there?
Yeah.
I'm looking for it under the project section.
Yeah, I think it might be under something like a computer desk, one more thing you can make with a router.
Mm-hmm.
But
here it is. I found the post.
Yep.
I will put the post on Twitter, and I will also open it up.
I was fortunate. I started following Twitter about a year and a half ago, and I stumbled across a wood chat hashtag.
Mm-hmm.
And that was my first experience with anybody doing a chat where guys were chatting about a specific subject, and you know, week after week at a specific time. And I got to tell you, it was the greatest thing since sliced bread, because it got me a chance to sit in and listen and how the guys who are actually professional woodworkers, in my opinion, how they go about doing things. And a lot of times you'll have access to a tool or wood or whatever, and you'll say, ah, that looks easy, and you'll go and try it and get slammed right in the head with a 2x4. It says, no, you don't have the knowledge to do that yet. You know, and you know, go talk to the Jedis. But that's, you know, that's been kind of the experience with it, and I've avoided a lot of mistakes and expensive sawdust just from hanging out and listening to you guys talk on WoodChat.
Great.
Cool.
So is it safe to say that you've took a non-conventional approach to learning woodworking?
That would be an understatement. Yeah. Yeah, I assume most people go to wood shop class, or they go to you know, some woodworking show and sit in on a class or several classes or pay someone to do it. But almost everything I've ever learned, I've taught myself because there's nobody around to teach me. So, yeah. Hydrate.
And looking at your furniture, your desk here, and the design is not one that most woodworkers would start off with as even an intermediate project, I think. It has a lot of curves, a lot of advanced...
It's not shaker. I'm telling you, it's not shaker.
No, it's not shaker. No. I like the design.
I do, too.
Yeah. Well, the one that's on my website is one that I designed based on someone else's work.
Okay.
And by that I said, there's a company, Legare or Legare, however it's pronounced,
yeah,
furniture. And they make this style of desk. But they didn't make exactly what I needed for my workroom. I wanted a corner desk, and I also wanted another desk off to the side. I'm not going to show you my shop right now.
All right.
No. Just trust me on that one. I'll get a sanitized picture later.
Hey, there's a reason that you only see this part of my shop right here.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. By the way, if you're wondering about the flames on the back wall, this used to be my son's bedroom. And this was a Hot Wheels design that I painted for him.
Well, I thought anyway, those were college colors.
Yeah. Well, that's right. Syracuse orange. Let's go orange.
I was thinking Chicago Bears.
No, well, they're good too. but the Peninsula style table that's on the website, they didn't have one that was long, so I combined kind of. They had a straight desk, and they also had one that bulged out to hold printers and things like that. And so I combined the two to get that shape, and then I added a couple of extra drawers. Shelves, not drawers.
So is the construction all just slipping parts together, the assembly?
Yeah. You could take this desk apart, reverse it, do pretty much anything you wanted to. In about 3 minutes, you can have a new configuration.
Wow. And how solid is it without anything locking it together? Is it rack or?
No, it's very solid. I could stand on it and jump up and down. Yeah, it does a pretty good job. Gravity helps a lot.
Guess the back panel, the gravity, okay, and then the back panel would also give a lot of rigidity, I would guess.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah, so I remember when I showed this. I spent the most time on that tabletop, getting that shape for the tabletop correct. Mm-hmm. And if you notice... on the very top of the desk, there are two places where the, what shall we call them, this
like
side
grommet,
piece.
The holder?
Yeah, yes. Up front.
Where
they come through. It's like a mortise and tenon.
Mortise, kind of. Yeah.
Joint. That took a lot of work because a router bit does not cut.
Square
hole.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so you had to do some pretty tight measuring to get it right. Mm-hmm. And one of the final tricks was actually measuring my router bit so that I could get exactly the right amount of clearance so that it was a snug mm-hmm. fit. Mm-hmm.
It looks to me like... Go ahead, Bill.
No, go ahead, Chris.
I was going to say that it looks like you spent a lot of time in the design and the engineering of this.
Yes.
And I don't know how much woodworking was involved, how much fine-tuning.
By the time I cut this desk, I had the clearances and everything for the locking portion down.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Because this was the second desk that I made. I made the other one first. But there was a lot of I know it doesn't look so like it would be very difficult, but I did a lot of hand routing after with round over bits and things like that, just mm-hmm. trying.
That's wondering.
Mm-hmm. And I don't believe I ever published a picture of it after I'd stained it and everything. That was another experience. So
finishing is always a constant topic.
Yeah.
Here.
I mean, you learn all of this stuff on the fly. Right. You really do. And I might use different techniques now than I did then. But mm-hmm. every project, I learn a little more.
Finishing is a great teacher of sanding technique or planing technique.
Mm-hmm. So, the prep.
Because it shows up. Every little microscopic error that you may have missed.
Yeah.
Once you put the finish on it, it's there. So.
Yeah, it's funny. I'm coming at it. I think Matt asked the question of whether I was coming at it from a non-traditional way. But I'm kind of coming into the phase where I'm going back to learn the basic skills now. Mm-hmm. Because I can make almost anything I can visualize on a CAD package and put it on the CNC router and make it happen. But if I want hand-cut dovetails or Chris's twisted table, which is awesome, by the way, there's a lot that goes into that that you don't typically get with the CNC router. I know most of you guys think routers are just for flat-pack furniture like that desk, but there are guys building Maloof-style chairs. With this, and so I'm learning all of that, and what's the important parts of it, and that's kind of my journey.
Do you use solid wood with the CNC router, or mostly sheet goods?
I've used both, yeah.
Okay. I know one of the benefits of sheet goods is that it's uniformly flat, or at least uniformly thick, and that lends itself well to machine techniques like this here.
Yeah.
Like your Morrison tenon leg to top joint, for example.
Mm-hmm. Now, it's funny. I just spent the last 3 weeks doing some stuff with maple and with black walnut, and I believe it's Cipolli, or however it's pronounced. Anyone?
Cipolli.
I always call it Cipolli.
Cipolli is what I say.
And that was some very expensive sawdust to make as I learned how to use the new joiner that I got. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I didn't have a joiner before, and I'm just going to tell this brief story and then be done with it. As you join a board,
on a joiner, I saw your tweet.
There. The in-feed table is lower than the out-feed table. Mm-hmm. This is all basic stuff for you guys, but for anybody who's tuning in who doesn't know that, like me. Okay. And this determines how much wood you're going to take off. If you put pressure on the in-feed side as you're planing the board through, and you continue on through, you're going to end up with a nice... excuse me, I've got it backwards. You're going to end up with a flat center and curved up ends. And it's going to happen every single time until you figure out that you put the pressure on the outfeed side so that stays flat and takes that piece off. I started with some 8-quarter wood and got down to about 6-quarter before I figured it out.
Yeah. cut it twice and it's still too short.
Yeah. So yeah. By no means am I an expert, but I will be someday.
I'm learning a lesson though.
Yes, I did.
And you probably won't do it again. So I'd say success.
And if one person out there doesn't do it the wrong way because of what I just shared, then I'm fine. So,
they should send you 2 quarters.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So anyway, that project came out very nicely. But I did that with hand tools as well, including learning to use hand planes.
Okay, that answers my question, because I was going to say, all right, being a CNC guy, have you ever touched a hand plane? So as a hand tool guy and a hand tool maker, that makes me very happy that you have used a hand plane before.
Almost all of the serious CNC guys, you know, I've talked with a lot of guys around the country. They use hand planes. They use what's that very nice flexible Japanese cutoff saw? They've got those.
As a beaky?
I believe so. They're, you know, they're using chisels. They're going through with rasps and files, and that's the difference. And that's why they can charge big bucks when they do a project for someone commercially, because of the finish work that they do after the machine is done.
Mm-hmm. Gotcha. Yep. Makes sense.
That's good to hear that it's not all just straight off the machine and then put it together. That they are doing some finessing, some handwork.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's the craftsman. Now you do have mm-hmm. guys who will just pack it in a box.
Yeah, they're in one sense of the word, they're hybrid woodworkers, right? They use power tools.
Yeah.
Yep.
And they finish with hand tools. Cody Lehman's bought a CNC router table, and he's been doing the LMNOP furniture and making step stools and things like that, but he uses it to cut the parts out of the sheet goods, and then he finishes it all up by hand. So, and he's doing pretty good. So, just a different type of hybrid woodworker, I think.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Nothing wrong.
My take on the CNC router is that it's just another tool in your arsenal.
It's a tool to use.
It's a tool that you can do multiple things with. I mean, you can replace a scroll saw. In some instances, you can replace a table saw. In other instances, you can replace a planer, in some cases, in a joiner. But, like all tools that are hybrid, I don't want to use the term hybrid, but there are compromises. It does some things better than others.
Yeah.
With any tool, there's a compromise.
Yeah. So, you know, just buying one won't make you a great woodworker.
Mm-hmm. A true craftsman uses only their teeth and their hands. Any tool that you...
The oil from their hair and the wax from their ears.
That's right.
Yeah.
And the nail from the fingers, yeah. So, Bill, on CNCs, if somebody wanted to get started, let's say they wanted to buy an off-the-shelf CNC, mm-hmm. didn't want to make their own, where would you send them? What would you recommend for them?
I'd talk to them first, because that's like saying to a guy, should he get a saw stop or should he go with a jet or a Powermatic? I'd find out what he intended to use it for and what size is going to fit in his shop.
Mm-hmm.
Then that narrows it down and tells you where to go from there.
Mm-hmm.
But you couldn't likely go wrong if you were to buy from either ShopBot, CamMaster, let's stick with those two for now. There are more, but in Canada, A, X, Y, and Z, I believe, is the name of the company. They're also a good product. But it's really all depends on the size you're getting.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know that I just run over to Rockler and buy a Shark CNC unless that's the size that does it for you.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's kind of small for my taste and for my needs.
Okay. Yeah.
But it is a solid machine. I don't want to put down Shark CNC.
No, CNCs they do tend to be big to have capacity, like you say, to be versatile. Mm-hmm. One question I've asked a few people, and they always look at me funny, and I've never got a straight answer, is can you mount it on the wall sideways?
As a matter of fact, yes.
Awesome.
But
it all depends on your work hold, right?
Yeah.
Exactly. It's funny. I will send you a picture of the one that I was planning to build that was very much like a panel saw. And someone else built it. I'm just writing a note to myself because it would take me about 10 minutes to look up the pictures. But, here are the issues, though. Just like a panel saw, you've got to have something to hold the wood at the base.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And you know, and it's got to be bolted to the wall.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. So it looks like the CNC in the middle of your shop behind your desk there is maybe a 4 foot or a 5 foot by 5 foot bed or bigger. Is that a table or a CNC? Actually, I don't know.
That's the CNC router. It's the one that I built. That's an earlier iteration. I've made a lot of changes to it since then. But it was 4 foot by 4 foot originally. Okay. Now it's 5 by 4.
And that's a big footprint for my shop especially. I know it wouldn't fit in my shop well without sacrificing something, like a workbench maybe.
Yeah. Well, it can also serve as a workbench.
Yeah. Now, I'd imagine you'd want to keep it very, very clean and not beat on it. So it might not be the best choice for a workbench.
Hello, look at my picture of my shop, clean. The bed of the CNC router is MDF, and in my case. And so you can replace those boards. You know, run down to Lowe's, get a sheet of MDF, rip it to size, throw it back up there, screw it down, glue it down, whatever. Mine has a ton of cuts into the surface of it. You can see every project I've ever made. And when it gets rough, you run it surface bit over it. Start again.
There you go. How critical is learning CAD to being successful with the CNC?
It's critical.
Yeah, that's what I was
expecting. I would say.
So maybe the first step before you buy or build a CNC is making sure that you can learn CAD.
Mm-hmm. If you can drive Google SketchUp, you can run a CNC.
Okay.
You can design on a CNC. You can't run one. That's also part of what John Kleinbaugh refers to as CNC hell.
That's encouraging.
there's three styles of software. There's the drawing program, which could be anything from Paint and Microsoft Paint to a CAD package. Then there's a CNC tool pathing package, like Vectric Aspire or VCarve Pro or Cut2D. Or MasterCam, all expensive pieces of software. And then there's another piece of software which actually makes the motors move. And each one of those has its own learning curve. So plug and play, push the button, and have it cut just doesn't exist, really. You're going to have to learn your craft.
Cool.
Would you compare it to the learning curve of, say, a hand plane or a jointer, or is it well above that or different? Or
I don't know. I learned CNC, and that jointer kicked. Well, let's keep this clean. if you are able to use a smartphone and an iPad, you have the potential to be a CNC operator.
Okay.
It's just a matter of dedication, learning, and, you know, not just expecting everything to magically happen. You got to think.
Yeah.
Cool.
Can't expect everything to magically happen. Screw that.
Yeah. No.
I don't want to work.
Yeah. It's like anything. I mean, if you wanted a quick way, Matt, to get into CNC, find somebody who's already doing it.
Mm-hmm.
They'll talk your ear off about it, and they'll show you what they're doing. And if not, there are people who do paid services that'll teach you. And, you know, I mean, if I were buying one of Scott's planes or whatever, you know, there's a learning curve to using Scott's plane.
Mm-hmm.
Scott can tell you how to use that plane, or he can, you know, have a class on how to use that plane. Well, it's the same thing with the CNC. There are guys who do it. So
there's a reason I sell more planes at shows than I sell online. Because when I can sit down and walk someone through how to use it, they're far more likely to buy it than someone that's just seen a picture online. Mm-hmm. Granted, I get both, but I even prefer the shows because then I know the person's going home with a plane that they know how to use.
But
you can walk through with someone, through something with someone, it makes all the difference in the world.
Wasn't that your class I saw earlier this year that was teaching people how to make the plane?
Yep, I did that.
Yeah, I mean, I saw that, and that got me excited, but one project at a time, I keep saying, you know.
Not to shoot myself in the foot, but there is a DVD coming out sometime, I'm guessing, in October, November. So.
Fantastic.
There you go, Bill.
Yeah. Yeah. Cool. And, I can't finish like you do, though, yet, so I'll have to work on that and maybe bend your ear.
Yeah, but we did some wood chats on that. You can go back and watch the videos.
That's episode number 37, right?
Yep. Oil varnish blend, rub, rub, rub. There you go.
There you go.
Let's start talking about that table, Chris.
I was going to say, we're over halfway into
sorry,
this.
Sorry, guys.
No, that's fine.
That's great. Nope. Great. I think we could spend an entire wood chat on CNC.
Yeah.
It's definitely fascinating.
And I think we will in the future.
Absolutely.
Probably learn some more about it before we get there, but...
Yeah.
Okay, so I have on my screen here a picture of Bill's design, and Bill can tell us what exactly it is, whether it's, is this a seat or is it a table?
I'm glad you asked that question. I saw the design, someone had a textured table in the telephone game here, not arts and crafts. Little mission style slats around the edge of the table. It was like two designs.
Okay, yeah, that was Jay Bates.
Jay Bates design. I like that. And when I saw that, the slats reminded me of, for some reason, Egyptian furniture. I had seen this Egyptian chair. I don't know if I can screen share with you or not.
I think this is the design you're talking about.
Yeah, that's the design I saw, and I looked at that, and it just said Egyptian furniture to me. I don't know why.
I can see that.
It's the tapers, I think.
Yeah. So I looked at that, and I said, "Boy, this would be really cool as kind of an Egyptian stool, or other." And I went out and I found a couple of pictures. Let me see if I can get that on my other monitor here. But I went out and I found some pictures of some Egyptian furniture that was out there, and I found a stool. And the Egyptian furniture tends to curve upward at the very edges. And I was a little far along into the design when I discovered that. Here's the picture. It's called a camel chair. I'm going to try and screen share so you can see this image if that works. There we go. Can you see that now?
Oh, okay.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Well, I kind of saw that, and I says, that's kind of cool. I wonder how the Egyptians would make this if they had the equivalent of a CNC.
Cool. That's a cool inspiration.
And that's kind of what got me started. But the other thing, how do I stop screen sharing?
I'll just click it. There you go.
Yeah.
Okay. So, anyway, this is actually a table, but it's more of a serving table. I was building cutting boards for my wife and daughter. That's some of that expensive sawdust I was talking about earlier. And that kind of got me into the alternating color scheme thing with the light and the dark colored wood. That's kind of where this started coming from. And the legs was from another chair later on in the Egyptian period. So I was kind of combining things, but more chairs than table. I'm not happy with the shape of the tabletop, but I also, you know, I ran out of time, and proportions aren't the greatest, but I can see what it needs. It needs to be slightly taller.
So how tall is this table in your design?
The very top edge is about 26 inches, but the problem is that the table portion, the flat part, is around 20.
That should be very low.
Okay, so, yeah. so that would be a little bit about coffee table height. Yeah.
Yep. If I had done it correctly, it would be able to fold up somehow, you know, to get it out of the way. But
I take it to something would articulate somewhere with the top onto the top of the leg into the top of the into the table.
If that
would slide back and forth.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. All of that is not in the drawing. In fact, I didn't even finish putting all the contrasting wood on one side of the table. You just got the idea. This just had to be this had to be a sketch, and you had to manually place each one of those in the CAD package, so it was not fun.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but mostly dowel joinery, and I'm not really sure how I would do the feet. They're staggered right now, and I think most of the Egyptian furniture I saw actually had feet that looked even regardless of how they folded, those round dowel pieces on the bottom. So I'd have to adjust that sort of thing. But I think the table portion should be thicker.
Okay. Yeah, yeah, I could see it being a little bit thicker.
Taller and thicker would
definitely
add a
lot to it. So. Yeah. Taller proportionately.
Yeah. Matt said something last week about it, that he hoped that I would do something non-CNC. Mm-hmm. And this could be built with a bandsaw and random orbit, not a random orbit, but an oscillating spindle sander and, you know, a drill press and a lot of patience.
Yeah.
But it could be done. You could do just a regular router table without the CNC and just have a pattern.
Yep.
You know, repeatable pieces.
So what I'm seeing, there's six leg parts that are identical, and then, I don't know, 20 slats that are identical, and then two dowels?
Yeah, basically. Mm-hmm. Yep, so it if the table were thicker, you could do a little more with the ends of the legs to make them interlock with another part that would prevent them from rotating up too far, or, you know, that sort of thing. There's a lot of ways you could go with it.
Mm-hmm. So I take it, because you got the color contrast on the top, the lower part, the main part of the top.
Sure.
I take it that's a solid filled, like, in between the slats of the table.
Yes,
there's a solid field contrasting. But then on the sides, from the pivot point of the legs up to the end piece there, is that open in between the pieces?
Yes.
Okay.
I think I could screen share again with you the actual CAD if you'd like, and I could rotate it around.
Cool. Okay.
Let's see.
That'd be kind of neat, so it'll give you this. It just changed that look entirely when you got a solid flat surface in the top and then that.
Let me change the shading a little bit so you can see it a little bit differently.
I'm thinking you could either build it with a single wood or else you could choose two contrasting woods and have a really bold-looking piece.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I removed one of the pieces from the front so that you could...
Okay.
See the contrast. But there's this style piece here in between each of these, and the ones in the six legs would have a slightly different shape with notches, et cetera, to hold it. And then these little spacers. Let me see. This may give you a little bit better idea. Let's see. No, that's not helping at all, is it?
show that front view again.
Sure.
It kind of adds a really unique... it just looks a lot different than the profile views. It's kind of cool.
Yeah. So that, you know, that's... It looks a little more Egyptian here than, you know, the profile views. It's a very different design.
Oh, yeah. I mean,
you know,
who knows where it's going to go from here. Like, I know I said that last week, too, but, like, I'm excited to see us taking some drastic changes again.
Yeah, you were asking about whether this part was open, and you can see here that it is. Yeah,
I like that. That's a new touch.
So, let's see. And I think that stopped the screen share.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. So, anyway, that's what I could do in the time allotted. But I don't know. Matt, you asked earlier if it was something that you'd build a model of. I think you could. The question is, you know, what would you use it for?
To look at.
Yeah. If you made it smaller, it could be like a serving tray that you could take out and, you know, prop up and
make it a little skinnier on, you know, width wise, and you could make it a TV tray.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you made it really small, you could put your salt pepper on it.
Yep. Really big, and we could land aircrafts on it. So, you know, there's any.
It's interesting that we mentioned that, because one of the projects I'm working on right now is, I'm calling it like loss of scale or something, and I'm trying to take components, sections of furniture, and scale them up really big to make them, like, for my first idea is a ball and claw foot. I'm going to scale that up so that you're sitting on the ball and the leg is your backrest.
Oh, that's awesome.
So I now need to work out how to build a 20-inch diameter sphere and not make it weigh 200 pounds. So I guess that's a big glue-up, lots of glue and like a segmented bowl type thing. And then, I don't know, turn it. I don't know how to turn a 20-inch. Find a big lathe, I guess. You have to carve a foot on it.
Very big.
It's just an idea, and that's all it is right now.
Well, if I were tackling it with CNC, I'd build it in layers and glue them together after I was done.
Ah.
But you're on your own.
Yeah, that's actually a good application. You could draw the whole thing out in CAD, then slice it up into 1-inch layers, and then route them out and glue them up, and then sand it, sculpt it smooth. Maybe that's my justification for a CNC.
If you need to justify one, then you don't need one. If you just want one, then you should get one. But yeah. it's did anybody really need a Mac computer or a PC when they first came out? I don't think so. But I somehow justified it and went and got one. Anyway, you know, it's what you want to do. If you know, if that's what you want to do, go for it.
Right.
Yeah. I'd love to see what you could do with a CNC.
Me too.
You and me both.
Yeah. Hey, if you're building them and sending them out, we'll take one.
send the check. I'll hook you right up, bro.
Oh, there's a check.
How much would that check be? Only answer if you want.
No, I believe in transparency. I built mine from a set of plans, and at the time I built it 2009, 2010, when I was done with the first iteration, because like I tinker, I can't leave it alone, I had spent just under $2,300.
Wow, that's pretty affordable.
Yeah, for a machine. I have no idea how much I have into it now, because I have changed so much of the machine. I machined aluminum parts to replace anything that was wood, using a big machine that the school was gracious enough to let me play with, and I think it was a fair deal because I got to teach the kids how to use it too. So, yeah, it worked out. I supplied all my own material. Yes, I am. Yeah.
I bet your wife knows how much you spent on.
If you wanted to build a comparable machine, you could do so for less than $4,000.
Wow.
Which is about the cost of a saw stop, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, about that. Yeah. Or about so, the same price the as building, like a shark or something, I think.
Yep. You know, you buy a few Festool products and you're right there. So
one of each of my planes, you'll be
yes. Yeah. So in my opinion, they're affordable if you build them. If you go out to buy one from any of the companies I mentioned, you're going to spend $10,000 to $25,000.
Do you think you're getting okay, so I guess that does answer my question. You are getting a better machine than what you would get for spending $5,000 or something.
No, I never said that.
Okay, would you agree with that?
Would I agree with that? No, I never said that.
I kind of surmised that based on your comparison of a $15,000 to $20,000 machine.
If you had the money to spend, would you build one yourself or buy a pre-built? I guess that's a way to answer.
But would you do that because it's fun to build or because you could get better quality?
See, it ended up being my hobby, too. Right now, I'll put my machine up against anybody's that's out there. But the point is, could I get a comparable machine off the floor and in the workshop working this week if I had a big enough paycheck? The answer is yes. So if you're going to use sweat equity, then you can build and be just as happy as if you spent the big buck and dropped, you know, $10,000 to $25,000 and bought a machine.
I think you just made a very, very, very good point that it's so easy to forget is how much your time is worth.
Yeah.
And so while you may have spent $2,000 to $5,000 in materials on your CNC,
yes,
the amount of time you put into it makes it far more valuable. So yes, there's definitely a trade off.
So here's a real question for you, Bill.
Sure.
I have thought about buying a CNC. My budget would be less than $10,000, and I probably wouldn't want to put in more than 2 or 3 weeks of work into building it.
Mm-hmm.
Or building, assembling.
Well, how many hours is
fine-tuning it?
Is that 40 hours a week? Or?
We've seen the way he
works.
This
is Chris. This is 120 hours a week.
That's what I was wondering, because for me, 2 or 3 weeks in the shop is 10 hours.
Yeah, I'd say maybe
the fastest
200 hours, maybe.
Oh, yeah, you can do that. The fastest that anybody has built the machine that I've seen has been 13 days.
Okay.
But that's one caveat. 13 days from when he had all the parts there.
Yeah. And he had probably built them before?
No.
No? Okay.
But I belong to a membership forum that's what we do. We build these machines. So there's, you know, maybe 600 or 700 guys who've built this machine already.
Okay.
And we document it all with pictures and photos, and we talk about it because it's our hobby. It's just like, you know, woodworking.
Mm-hmm.
So that guy studied the forum for a couple of weeks, and then he went for it. Mm. And he, you know, he just, he rocked it, you know. So if I were helping you telephonically, Chris, you could get this done so quick, you know, we could do it and would chat him in a month from now.
I was going to say, I think that 13 days Ooh. Is a challenge to you, Chris.
right now it's a challenge to find 13 days, but yeah. Maybe I'll go that route. What are the parts? Wait for them to all come in and then book off 2 weeks.
Yeah.
It would definitely be an epic tweet-off build.
Yeah. Oh, definitely. Wow. Yeah. One question I've got for you, though. Have you ever cut metal?
Yes.
Okay. Do you have tools to cut metal?
Not specific. Well, okay.
Do you have a bandsaw?
I've got a bandsaw, yes.
Can you get a metal cutting blade?
I could.
Okay. And you can cut metal.
Okay.
Can you weld?
I cannot weld. I know someone who can weld.
Because I wanted you to build a wooden base anyway. Because yours is going to be so much cooler than everybody else's.
No, mine's going on the wall, remember?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe.
Maybe. Yeah.
But I guess you still need a frame, right?
You need an A-frame.
Can they be twisted?
That would be so cool.
Can you use a spoke shave on aluminum T-track, Chris?
With the carbide blade, I believe I can.
Hey, did you guys see the link that Adam Maxwell put in the Twitter feed there?
No.
Put it in the chat room, yeah. But it looks like the Egyptian chair that might have inspired you. Here, I'll screen share it. Let's see if I can get a bigger picture of it here.
Now I'm seriously thinking about...
I got it.
It's actually a pretty small picture.
I got it, Matt.
There it is.
Actually, it's not that exact chair, but that was the style, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, awesome. Yeah, and that I was
chair
looking for
isn't
that.
Folding, I think. I don't think it folds. No. It's got a backrest.
Yeah, I think that chair is stationary and probably more money than your CNC will cost you. But, yeah. I'm really surprised that you're thinking about doing that. Not because, because you're such a craftsman already. I don't know. There seems to be a slight bias in woodworkers.
And a lot of woodworkers. Towards the push button. I think so, but I don't. Yeah. Like Scott said, it's just another tool. Like you said, it's another tool.
Yep.
I don't think it makes me any
I'm a hand tool guy saying that, so there's hope for the world.
Yeah. Now, I will admit that when I made the cutting boards, they were N-grade cutting boards, okay? I know this is a baby step for you guys, but for me it was a big deal, okay? So.
They're tough to do.
Yeah. Well, I got them all glued up, you know, the N-grade flipped up, and then went to flatten them.
Yep.
They're supposed to be flat, but if you don't get them clamped just perfectly, you get a little waviness here and there. End grain does not sand very easily. It takes forever. Mm-hmm. And, I ended up with something that looked flat, but to the hand was kind of wavy.
Yeah. See, I think the way I would have done that, if I were you,
Bill. Oh, it wasn't Adam. Sorry, it was Wildworks. I screwed up.
It was the other Adam.
Credit where credit's due.
Yeah. I think I would have dropped on the CNC table and run your surfacing bit over it, and then if you had to, use a hand plane set very, very lightly just to get it nice and smooth.
It's funny you should say that.
Because that's what you do.
That's exactly what I did.
Yeah.
I showed the cutting board to my wife, and she says, that's really nice, honey. It looks beautiful. But it's not flat.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when I take my knife, I'll be right back, dear. So, back to the garage. I love my wife. Yeah. She she's making me a better woodworker. And, so I went back and I thought about it. And I planed a flat spot on a piece of plywood that I had clamped to the table, carpet taped the board, cutting board down, and then took my surfacing bit and I removed a 64th of an inch from the entire top, mm-hmm. and then I went at it with the planes and the sandpaper, and yeah. it's fine now.
See, there's always a different yeah. way.
Yeah, I was gonna put it into the thickness planer, which would have been a bad move.
I've never tried that, but I've heard that it can be successful with light cuts.
I talked with Mark, the Wood Whisperer. I can never pronounce his last name. Spagnuolo.
Mark Spagnuolo.
Spagnuolo. About it, and he indicated that he would not do it because the thickness planer knives catch on the edge and can, you know, start projectile throwing your cutting board all over the shop. And if he was going to do it, he'd round over the edges first. Mm. But he didn't recommend it. So I followed his advice. Mm-hmm. And, yeah. So, still here.
It's good.
Yeah, do not try and put end grain across the face of a joiner.
Yeah, I wouldn't do that.
Yeah.
Yep. So, yeah. Prior to gluing it end grain, it was fine to go through the joiner, but not once you'd flip them. So. Yeah, so, very cool. Chris, I've been meaning to ask you, you have pictures of this twisted table on your website.
I do.
Yeah. You can see the sides of that. Is it twisted all the way front and back
on the aprons?
Yeah, on the aprons, yeah.
The front and the sides are. The back is not. The back okay. is just straight and flat.
Get
any more pictures if you like, if you want a 360 or underside. And
yeah. That is a very cool table.
I'll trade you for a CNC. Or parts for a CNC, maybe.
Hmm. Wow.
That's an interesting.
That might actually be worth it. Yeah.
I'm thinking the same
thing. I've got to show it to the chief furniture acquisition officer before I can take you up on that. She does. She does not like my taste in woodworking as a rule. But,
hopefully, I'm the exception.
We all deal yeah. with that. My wife wants everything painted white.
So my signal cut out there for a second. Are you trading a table for a CNC? Is that what's going on?
That's the proposed idea.
Hmm. I think it's a brilliant idea.
I can trade an 8-year-old beagle.
I thought you were going to say
eight. No, an 8-year-old dog. I'll box them up in some bubble wrap. I'll send them wherever you are, and you send me a CNC.
Hmm. My son would take you up on that in a heartbeat because he's been asking for a dog. But this is an interesting thought.
I'll trade a set of plans.
It is, isn't it?
Yeah, because I really admire that table. I'll tell you, that's a good deal, too. I bet I could find you a taker. I really could.
So Bill.
I wouldn't have room for it.
So let's actually get back. Let's get out of the market. Let's get out of the market bazaar here.
Okay.
I feel like we're on eBay or OfferUp.
Yeah.
Chris started it.
Yeah.
If you were to have more time to spend with that table design and to not worry about construction methods. You could use CNC if you wanted. You could use 3D printed wood pulp if you wanted. You could use whatever you wanted.
We're back to the telephone game design, right?
Yeah. What more would you want to do to that design?
Most Egyptian, because my theme was kind of sort of Egyptian, modern Egyptian maybe.
Yep.
Egyptians were big on ornamentation.
Very, yeah.
And that table didn't have any ornamentation on it. Mm-hmm. So I would find some tasteful or tacky, depending on depending on who you're talking
tasteful
to.
Tasteful or tacky, whatever works.
Yeah, ornamentation to put on there. I think I might try I was not happy with the wings that went up and out on the side, because I was thinking of wings as I looked at that. So maybe I would convert it to look more like the Egyptian griffin wings.
Oh.
Or like maybe the everyone's seen Harrison Ford, the Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Maybe
the angels that are hanging over the edge.
Because they can't actually look at God, right? So they have to hide their
right.
eyes.
Yeah. That's one aspect of it. I'd definitely come up with a better system to align things. Because I think when you went to assemble that on the dowels, that would be a chore trying to get everything together before the glue set.
Welcome back, Scott.
Stupid charter internet.
Yeah. I think, Bill, you could glue up most of the segments of the tabletop in one glue up, and then glue up the rest of them with the legs in the second glue up.
Mm-hmm.
So everything in front of the legs would be one glue up, everything behind would be another, and then you put everything together in another glue up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I might make the very ends of the wing portion into... you saw in the Egyptian chair how it was the handle, the ornamented handle, gold handle, something like that. That would be really more functional. This table is more like a little modern stuff that you would have seen from maybe this modern now. It's not modern. The 70s or 60s or 70s around in there woodworking. I'd work on the legs a little more too. I kind of like the shape, but it's not perfect.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, this is what you know. This is only a couple hours worth of sketching or whatever.
Yep.
And And I'd definitely talk to someone about proportion.
It looks like a chair or a seat to me. I guess a bench.
Yeah, and because I was looking at chairs, it looks like a chair.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you could definitely scale it up to be twice as high proportionally, and you'd have a nice side table.
Yeah.
I can see maybe draping a towel or linen cloth over the top, so it goes over the ends and down with like the rope ends, whatever they're called, tassels or something.
Yeah, I can see that. I think maybe I would, if I were going to play with the design more, I'd actually make it a chair. As strange as that may seem.
Now,
chairs to go with it, you know.
Okay, and how would you get a backrest into it? Would you take the arms and then curl them up into the backrest like that other example we saw?
Probably. That's one way of doing it. Since you're doing profiles, you could just create a staggered, partially sculpted backrest. Then you wouldn't be able to cut it with a jigsaw. But you
Can I show you guys something real quick? Because when I saw this, it reminded me. It definitely reminded me of the Egyptian, but it also reminded me of. I'll show you this. A little bit. Can you see that?
Okay, yeah.
So, the construction method is kind of similar, right? You have lots of curved slats that are glued together in interesting ways to create a form.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it would be interesting if you could go full C-on-C craziness on this. You could do where the sides come up, but in a semicircular form so that you actually go right into a backrest as well.
Yes.
Right? And now, Chris has got this table, I can't remember what you call it, Chris, where all the all the pieces come in from the top into one complex...
The V table?
Yeah.
Yeah, I can
see all these slats coming together at some point in the middle there. I don't want to do that. I want to stop screen sharing. Stop it. Is it still screen sharing? Stop it. Stop it. There we go. Is it still screen sharing? It sure is, isn't it? My God, just stop.
All I see is black.
Okay, let's try to get my camera going. But all those slats, if they were in a semicircle, you'd have the sides, you'd have the back, they come down, but then the legs are even in a separate thing. It could be pretty cool. It would require some heavy-duty calculations and interesting joinery, but it could be pretty cool.
Looking at that chair that Adam posted, the Egyptian one, that I don't think of incorporating a backrest by attaching it only to the armrests.
Yeah.
I usually think of it as directly down the legs, between the legs, or up from the seat. So that's something I hadn't thought of before.
Like that one. I was trying to find something on Pinterest, but it's not happening quick enough. Let's give it one more shot here.
This table that Matt was talking about, the crazy intersection. I'm still working on that one. I kind of have it figured out. I don't know, Bill, if this could be CNC'd, this joinery, I would buy or build a CNC just for this to create these, because I think these are awesome. And I can tell you it's about 6 hours of work to cut 3 joints.
Oh, my.
A billion to figure it out.
It's funny you mention it. I've been contemplating doing a book on... some CNC joinery, because it wouldn't be a long book, but an ebook, basic joints and how to go about programming them or whatever. But I read a bunch of books on the name escapes me, but it's old books whose copyright has gone out.
Yep.
And there were a lot of books about woodworking and joinery.
Allgrove.
I think it was the Gutenberg project.
Oh, okay. All right.
At any rate, I saw a bunch of different types of joinery that I hadn't really commonly seen, and I started programming some of them, and I got maybe 15 or 20 joints done before I got I probably would have ADD if I were being diagnosed as a child, because I'm like, ooh, shiny thing, squirrel. And I'm off to another project, and a lot of projects don't get done. But something like that joint, once you figure it out, that would be an awesome thing to do. But squirrel. Yeah, that's me. Yeah. So, I'm not going to find that thing on Pinterest that looks like so. Okay. There's someone.
So Bill, let's assume you were awesome at finishing.
Yeah.
What wood would you select for the table, and how would you finish it?
I was thinking when I first designed it. Either curly maple, bird's eye maple, something like that for the lighter shade wood.
Mm-hmm.
Something with some figure in it that's not just going to be straight green. And obviously black walnut was my other thought. But there are so many different woods you could use. I mean, if wood were, if wood grew on trees, and you could afford it, that'd be great. But those are the two that I was thinking of. but I'm open to suggestions. Wouldn't I know it's not a hardwood, but well, a very hardwood. Poplar sometimes gets really cool colorations, you know, between light and dark wood.
I'm not sure you'd have enough strength in this design. The legs look fairly delicate.
Yeah.
Rosewood, I think, would look really sharp. Maybe ebony and holly or something.
Oh, you could go with purple heart.
I hate purple heart.
Purple and yellow heart, that would be interesting.
Green heart, red heart. Have a Christmas version.
I hadn't seen green heart. Yeah. Hadn't seen green heart. I just recently discovered a hardwood place nearby, finally. So now I have access to some wood that you guys take for granted, and some exotic woods if I can afford them. So
I think that Pacific Yew would be a great choice for this design.
Pacific Yew.
It's actually a softwood, but it's very, very hard, and it's very resilient too. They use it for wooden bows, as in bow and arrow. Maybe even ash. Ash
would I was thinking, that's funny, I was thinking ash, yeah.
Zebra wood, wow. Adam Wheel just mentioned zebra wood. Wow, that could be interesting. Or black and white ebony.
Oh, the zebra wood is so splintery, though. It just gets all...
Yeah, right next to purple heart.
Mm-hmm. I tried doing an inlay earlier in the year with some purple heart and discovered just how splintery it was.
Yeah. My least favorite wood.
Yeah. I did get it, finally. But the project that was supposed to take a day ended up taking a week.
Mm-hmm. I know that.
That never happened.
You could do a butternut and walnut.
That would be cool.
Yeah, I'm not sure either have enough strength, though, especially probably the combination.
I might use smaller holes for the dowels and then just use a metal dowel.
Yeah, it's the bottom half of the legs that I'm concerned about.
Yeah,
they do get kind of thin.
Just double the size of it, and you're good to go.
Well, you could cast the base in, I don't know, bronze or iron. That'd be pretty cool, I think. I guess maybe I'm thinking a bit about Jamil's crisscross vice.
Yeah.
I could go with that, I think.
There are so many different ways that you could go. I mean, first off, would anybody really build the thing? But you know, if you did, choosing the wood would be really important because of
very important.
Yep.
The grain. I don't know. Maybe even. I'm still stuck on maple though. I like the
oak. Oak would be a good choice too, I think.
Yep.
If you needed a contrast with maple, you could do. You just tweak some of the maple for the contrast, like bake it or to get that kind of like what Lee Valley does on their chisels. They do that baked maple.
Caramelized.
Caramelized, yeah. That would look kind of neat because you'd have the same grain pattern but a different color contrast.
Our lumber... Hang on a second, guys. I'll be right back.
Adam Weil is cracking me up.
Yeah.
If I was to do a design change to the base, I would make the dowel that the legs go into. Oh, sorry, Bill couldn't hear to do that. I said headphones on. If I was to make a change to the table, I would to the base. I would change the dowel that the legs go into.
Mm-hmm.
I'd try and make that a little bit more interesting than just a dowel.
Yeah,
and I worry a little bit about the tippiness of the table. So I might do something bigger, but if we go with the griffin wings, there might be an opportunity to do something really cool down there, right? So if you could take this from an Egyptian design to almost an organic design where you add the griffin wings and you make these I guess I'll call them struts, a little bit more spine-like and rib-like, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
Make the things that the legs go into actually maybe foot-like or claw-like. I mean, you could go Game of Thrones on this, right?
Yeah. One of the interesting things that I saw was a lot of the Egyptian furniture used animal legs as the legs. They used like rear paws and things. When you mentioned the wood, the baked wood, Scott,
mm-hmm.
this is actually white oak that they cook longer in the kiln as they're doing it. Let me see if I can add the other white oak sample here. They were nice to give me some samples of their woods, white and red. But you can see this oh, red oak, you know, the difference between the...
That is, yeah.
And they just bake it.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Try to think of what color
has tannins in it.
Is that kind of a cherry darkness?
Yeah. Yeah, and they sometimes bake it even longer than that, and it comes out not quite burnt toast color, but, you know, it's really pretty impressive wood.
Like a mahogany, maybe?
Yeah.
It's a peely-ish.
Yeah. So, yeah, that's all. I was trying to see if there were any interesting pieces in here. But.
Ooh. Is that...
pretty cool.
What's it called?
Ambrosia?
WSM.
Yes. Ambrosia maple. Ambrosia?
Yeah.
Wormy maple.
Wormy maple, I think, yeah. Yep. Anyway, their primary business is hardwood floors there, and so they have all these samples, but they also do banisters and other things, and they'll cut your wood to order. It's just an amazing place. I wish I had a few $100,000 in a climate-controlled shop to to buy all the wood and stick it in there. Yeah.
So, Chris, who's next in the build?
That is Pete Harbin, I do believe.
That second wind?
Second wind, yes. So I let him know earlier, I mentioned him in a tweet, saying, hey, you're up next. And, yeah, like Scott says, it'll be exciting to see the next one, see what inspires him and see where he goes with this.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to lie. I thought by this point we'd all be sick of this. But
yeah,
I'm really enjoying it. I love seeing cool. each new design.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. It's pretty cool.
I think if we kind of slow-poked our way on, like from... It kind of took a while to pick up. It was my design, then Matt's was very close, then Vic's was very close, and then we've kind of been getting on a roll and having some more radical designs and more bigger changes and... No two alike, really, since then.
We escaped gravity.
Yes.
Right? And now we're flowing through space. Mm-hmm. But, Chris, if you look at Bill's design, he still has the drop.
It still has the drop.
Yep.
Yeah.
It's still there.
Mm-hmm. So, no one's been able to get rid of that drop yet.
I don't know why is that part so enduring?
Because I think it has unique.
Different.
It's different.
Yeah.
It's different.
Almost every single table has a flat top. Just a flat top. It might have a different shape to the perimeter. It might have an edge detail applied, but tabletops are flat, right? And so to have a tabletop that isn't flat but functional is kind of cool, right? But
cool, unique, whatever. Yeah.
That drop top is still in there.
Yeah. It's funny. I wanted to get rid of that drop top. Because I couldn't think of a good logical reason to have it.
Yeah.
But it just keeps popping up.
That's why you keep it.
Yep.
Yeah, this is the evolution here. I'm just rolling through my screen here. That's mine. And then Matt's, Vic's, And then Scott. Then Greg Palmer.
I still like Scott's.
Yeah, me Scott's too. Is... Yeah. But not that much. Just kidding. Megan Fitzpatrick, Diami, Brian Van Vreede. I like his design. That's one of my favorites.
Mm-hmm. I think we need to make Maybe Diami do it again, just because I want to see Diami try to make a styrofoam sample again.
Tim Charles, and I liked Eric's a lot.
A lot.
It wasn't really a drop top, but it was a double level.
Mm-hmm. I like Tim's as well, with little doors on the side.
Mm-hmm. If I had seen Eric's design before I got started, because I missed Eric's design until after.
Oh, you went off of Tim's, didn't you?
Yeah. Okay. I'm not sure what it would have ended up looking like, because I kind of like that a lot.
You can do it for fun if you want.
Yep.
Yeah.
But boy, now the pressure's off. Somebody else is turning the hot seat.
Yep.
Yeah, I'm getting more excited to have my turn at this again. So right now we've got six people lined up, Pete being the first, and then five after him. And our next open slot is the week starting October 16th. And then we're open all the way down after that. So if you want to sign up, and I think we all strongly encourage that you do, it's a lot of fun, and you think you'll learn a lot as well, get a hold of myself or Matt, and we will get you signed up.
And should we have a I don't know if you are yet or not, Phil, but I know that Chris and Matt are being slackers and not making it WIA this year, but I think we should have a telephone design game, or WoodChat telephone design game meetup at WoodChat, and we could have a contest to see who could build their design the quickest.
I'm surprised you proposed that, Scott.
Wow.
What's that?
I'm surprised that you proposed that. Yours is one of the tougher ones, I think.
Yeah. I wouldn't have time to do that.
It's just for everybody else.
Yeah.
Can I bring my machine?
I think that's how we'd have to do all of them.
Yeah.
I could build mine pretty quickly, I think.
Yeah, I think so.
Mine was pretty basic.
Straight joinery always.
Yeah, that's kind of one of the cool things. I kept mine basic to try not to scare people away, and everyone went crazy on me. Got all these radical curves, and I don't think we saw straight lines until design 8 or something.
Well, the next time you get a go at it, just go all out. And don't hold back this time. So
I like Diami's design. It kind of reminds me of like a Maloof style. A little bit, that he's got the flowing joints where they go together. I'd like to see somebody actually try and Maloof it. If that, it's a verb now. Yeah, just go ahead and Maloof it. But, But not to put any ideas in anybody's head. I want to see the originals, but that might be fun. That if I were to draw try something else, that might be a fun thing to try. I don't think I could build it. No.
Well, if there's one rule you need to know about sculpted furniture, it's to cut your joinery first.
Yep.
It doesn't work if you sculpt first, then try and join it. It's very, very, very difficult.
Yeah. Yeah. Those of us who bought a bandsaw within the last 2 years have figured that out with, as Bill would say, expensive sawdust. So.
Yeah.
And then you end up building little wedges and shims to hold stuff back in its old shape.
Yeah, and then try and sand it back in so that nobody can tell. Yeah. I'm assuming you guys use things like rasp and power road replane thing they have.
I use an Arbitech wheel. They've got a turboplane and like chainsaw discs and other stuff. I've got two angle grinders. One miniature takes a wheel about 2 inches diameter, and one takes a 4-inch. And then I've got rasps as well and sanders and such.
Yeah, that's on my to-do list. It's fun learning the fundamentals learning the real woodworking skills to go along with what my mind can see. But my hands can't build yet. So it's fun in that aspect. I never thought that I would get this much into woodworking when this all got started. But it seems to be the progression here.
Mm-hmm. Yep. I think I once commented that my perceived reality is so much better than actual reality. And what I want to do is try and make my perceived reality reality.
Bless you. I wish you could see the table that's in my head. Instead of the one that's on my CAD package.
Okay.
Yeah, that would...
Thank you for saying CAD before you said package. Sorry, I had to do it. I'm getting punchy.
Yeah.
Hear the crickets?
Should we wrap up now before we hear anything else?
I think we should wrap up.
Before
things get a little bit too crazy. My camera's still not working, right?
Yeah, I still see black.
Okay, well then, I'll just be the voice from the black box and say, hey everybody, thanks for attending Wood Chat for September 4th, 2013. Today we talked to Bill Griggs about his deep descent into the world of CAD, CNC, and now back into traditional woodworking. And we took a look at his telephone design game table that was had a little Egyptian inspiration in it. So we do this every Wednesday at 7 p.m. Pacific and 10 p.m. Eastern. And if you want to participate in the telephone design game challenge, just let Chris or I know at Uppercut Wood or at Flair Woodworks. But remember that Wood Chat goes 24/7, 365 over on Twitter with hashtag Wood Chat. If you have a question, a concern, you need a tip, you need help, whatever you need encouragement, just send us a tweet with hashtag WoodChat, and I'm one of the friendly WoodChatters will be glad to help. So we are wrapping it up, and this is Mac Rattle saying adios.
And this is Chris saying adios. Thanks for watching.
Scott saying hasta la vista.
And this is Bill saying, I don't want to go, but I have to. Thanks for having me, guys. I had a blast.
Great. Yes, we'll have to have you on again, Bill.
Good night, everybody.
Good night.